No further introductions. It is therefore time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. I've said many times around the province, the part of the People's Guarantee I'm most excited about is our commitment on mental health. It is the dirty little secret in Ontario's health care system, and no matter what spin or rhetoric we hear from the Liberal government, we're not doing enough. So I wanted to give the Premier a chance today to respond whether the Liberal government will match the $1.9 billion in additional new funding for mental health that our party has put forward to make sure we close the gap on mental health services in the province of Ontario.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I certainly agree with the Leader of the Opposition that there is much more that needs to be done on mental health, Mr. Speaker. Mental health care in this province is an area where we're catching up. Over the last decade to 20 years, Mr. Speaker, there has been increased awareness of mental health concerns, and that has meant, rightly, that there are more people who are presenting with mental health issues and that those need to be dealt with. But, Mr. Speaker, the remedy that the opposition party is putting forward is inadequate. That's the reality,
totally
Mr. Speaker. Over the last 10 years, we've
inadequate.
Invested $10 billion. What they're
you
proposing is go forward $1.9 billion over 10 years. Mr. Speaker, that is not enough. We are going to commit to more than that, Mr. Speaker, because there is more that is needed.
It's not enough.
Thank you. Told me what you want. We're in mornings. Thank you. No, don't look at me. Look at yourselves. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier. Maybe the Liberal Research Bureau took a day off. Maybe the government's own public accounts have an error in it. But I think we all know the reality, and that's that they haven't invested in mental health. Because the stories we hear, the horrifying stories we hear across the province, wouldn't be happening if we had a government that made this a priority. You know, the CEO of the Children's Mental Health Ontario, Kimberly Moran, told me that children are waiting as long as 18 months for mental health care. 18 months. And the Premier says she's done all this investment. It doesn't show in the government's public accounts. It doesn't show in the care and treatment that's available in the province of Ontario. And I want to ask the Premier, is waiting 18 months adequate for a young person who has the courage to come forward and say they need help? Is that adequate in the province of Ontario?
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'm happy to meet with any member of the PCs, including the Leader, to go through in detail their erroneous calculation. Mr. Speaker, we know that this party has a history of getting the math wrong, and they've done it yet.
The member from Dufferin-Caledon is warned. I'm serious. Finish.
Mr. Speaker, we know that that party has a history of getting the math wrong, and they've got it wrong again. In fact, if you look at their commitment for the next 10 years of an additional $1.9 billion, that is in stark contrast to our very real and delivered investment of new funding using exactly the same methodology of more than $10 billion over the last decade. Mr. Speaker, they need to correct the record. It is not historic what they're proposing.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier. Clearly, the Premier and the Minister of Health haven't actually looked at their own public accounts where it shows the allocations on mental health. Now, the reality is it's easy to attack the opposition and say you disagree with these assertions. But, Mr. Speaker, you know, I'm quoting a stat from Kimberly Murray.
I'm getting a troll over here, if you just stop.
Speaker, I'm quoting a stat from Kimberly Moran, the CEO of the Children's Mental Health of Ontario. You're disagreeing with her assessment. The Globe and Mail just this week wrote an article that is shocking, horrifying, that if in cases of a young person who's tried to take their own life, they don't get to see a psychiatrist in 6 months. 6 months. That's a Globe and Mail article. And so I know it's convenient to pass this question off to a minister. I want to know from the Premier,
question.
Do you think waiting 18 months is adequate? Do you think waiting 6 months for a psychiatrist is adequate? Do you accept these wait times for mental
Thank
health
you.
Care in the province of Ontario?
Thank you. Seated, please. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, that's absolutely not acceptable. That's why this government has made the largest mental health investment in Canada's history. Not what they're proposing. What they're proposing falls far short, Mr. Speaker, and I'm happy to share the math with them. And now I understand why the Globe and Mail characterized their proposal as fiscally risky, economically dubious, Mr. Speaker. The math doesn't add up, and I'm beginning to feel sorry for that party, as eventually over time, and I'm happy to assist them with this, they will realize that their calculations are so bad and they are so far off the mark that it represents roughly one-fifth of the new investment that we've made in mental health over the last decade, Mr.
Yeah.
Speaker. This results in a dramatic flattening of the curve of the increased
yes,
investments that this province has made.
Simply
mental health
enough.
Is critically
yeah.
important, much more important than they're giving it.
Thank you. Minister of Children and Youth Services is warned. New question, the Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. We all know that Goreway was among the companies that gamed the system for over $260 million of ineligible expenses. And Goreway executive Rob Colbeck has been at the center of this latest scandal. Rob Colbeck's December 1st resignation letter states he is resigning as the co-chair of the Market Renewal Working Group, not as a member. And according to the IESO website, he remains a member.
Wow.
Mr. Speaker, why is an executive from Goreway allowed to remain on the board given the scandal of inappropriate expenses? The same people who gamed the system should not be the ones rewriting
exactly.
the rules.
Exactly.
So directly to the Premier, will this be addressed and addressed immediately?
Minister of Energy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As we've said over the last week since the auditor brought forward her report, any abuses of the system, Mr. Speaker, are completely unacceptable, and that's why we're pleased that the system operator has investigated those market participants and where significant wrongdoing was present, Mr. Speaker. Compensation has been recovered and returned to the ratepayers. There's $168 million of the $200 million in ineligible costs. As also mentioned by the Leader of the Opposition, Mr. Speaker, there have been resignations from the Market Renewal Committee, Mr. Speaker. The two chairs have moved off of that committee, Mr. Speaker. And moving forward, looking at Goreway, Goreway also made changes after they found that they were weren't complying with the system, Mr. Speaker. They were fined a record $10 million, Mr. Speaker,
Answer.
And $100 million of that money was recouped by the ISO. We're making sure that we have a system that is going to be rebuilt.
The member from Leeds Grenville is warned.
They have made significant changes, Mr. Speaker, and the ISO is constantly monitoring as
Answer.
Well.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, my question about why that individual is still a member was not answered, but I'll try a different angle. One of the companies in the Auditor General's was a government-run OPG, one of the companies amid this scandal. Yesterday, the minister told us that OPG repaid all of their ineligible expenses by 2015. And we know the former CEO was given a $500,000 bonus the following year. Why was he given this $500,000 bonus? Was it to keep quiet on the scandal? By the way, Mr. Speaker, it wasn't that the government found this. They got caught. That's how it came out. They didn't find it. They got exposed by the Auditor General.
Minister.
Ask him what's happening.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The innuendo that's coming from the opposition continues to just fester, Mr. Speaker, and it just shows that they really don't understand how this system is working, Mr. Speaker. OPG actually stepped forward when they recognized, Mr. Speaker, that they were claiming ineligible expenses. They worked with the ISO. That's why there was no fine imposed by the ISO on OPG at the time, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that they actually recoup those costs, making sure that they can understand understand the rules moving forward. And as OPG said, Mr. Speaker, the audit did determine that there were differences in understanding what constituted eligible costs under the program, Mr. Speaker. In respect of some of what were thought to be eligible costs, OPG repaid certain claimed amounts after discussions concluded on what constituted eligible costs. That's what both OPG and the ISO had come to a conclusion with, Mr. Speaker, way back in 2015.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, the Minister of Energy says we don't know how it's working. Well, I know exactly how it's working. This government has allowed executive power executives to expense raccoon traps and scuba gear. It's ridiculous. It's disgusting, Mr. Speaker. And while nearly tens of millions of dollars has yet to be repaid.
The member from Essex is warned. Carry on.
Mr. Speaker, there's still tens of millions of dollars in inappropriate expenses that have yet to be repaid. And so my question to the Premier, and hopefully the Premier will actually answer this time, Mr. Speaker, is can we get a guarantee that the tens of millions of dollars in inappropriate expenses that have not been retrieved by the taxpayers, that
question.
We have a commitment that the taxpayers will get those funds back by December 31st, yes or no to the Premier?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So the important thing to understand, and I think we can all agree, Mr. Speaker, is that any abuse of the system is completely unacceptable, and that's why, Mr. Speaker, we were pleased to see the ISO act on the recommendations, not only from the Auditor General, Mr. Speaker, but from the market surveillance programs and committees that are done both by the OEB and by the ISO, Mr. Speaker. They've made sure that they've brought forward new practices and new principles to make sure things like this, like abuses like this, Mr. Speaker, don't happen again. Because we on this side of the House want to ensure that we continue to bring forward programs that help ratepayers lower their bills, Mr. Speaker. And that's what we have done as a government. We've brought forward the Fair Hydro Plan, which brought forward a 25% reduction, helping all families right across the province, and many, many other programs.
Answer.
But when it comes to these two programs, Mr. Speaker, the ISO has put in place new changes that are making sure things like this will not happen again, Mr. Speaker.
Good question. The Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Ontario's hospitals have been underfunded for decades. Ontario families have been coming forward with heartbreaking stories of suffering in overcrowded hospitals for months now, while the Liberal government has called any criticism fear-mongering. But the Ontario Hospital Association says that that criticism is called for. The OHA says hospitals are on the brink of a crisis. Will the Premier, for once, listen to the experts and take the actions that the OHA is calling for?
Well, Mr. Speaker, we are taking this issue very, very seriously, Mr. Speaker, and I do take what the OHA says very seriously. I think it's extremely important that we listen to people on the front line who know what is happening in the hospitals, and that we combine that with our own capacity and our own knowledge, and that we come up with solutions, Mr. Speaker, which is exactly why we are expanding the number of beds in the system. It's exactly why we put a 3% increase for hospitals in our budget, Mr. Speaker. It's why we have put an infusion of cash into the system, Mr. Speaker, understanding that there are needs. I believe in that same report, Mr. Speaker, that the association calls for increased home care funding, Mr. Speaker, increased long-term care funding, all of which we are doing. So we take that very seriously. We are in the process of expanding, particularly at this time of year, Mr. Speaker, expanding capacity in the hospital system, and we will continue to work with stakeholders.
Supplementary.
Speaker, the fact is that this Premier and her health minister have arrogantly ignored the experts repeatedly when it comes to hospital care. They shorted the system $300 million in the last budget, Speaker. She refuses to listen to patients and their families. She refuses to listen to doctors and frontline health care workers. And she refuses to listen to the Ontario Hospital Association, which has been ringing alarm bells about the overcrowding and hallway medicine since the last budget, Speaker. Will this Premier now finally admit that she was wrong to freeze hospital
budgets for a decade and actually invest in the quality care that Ontario families deserve.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, the Leader of the Third Party knows that our health care and our hospital budget has continued to increase year over year. We invested this year between the budget and the fall economic statement an additional $600 million into the hospital system, $1.3 billion over the next 3 years to decrease wait times, Mr. Speaker. And I applaud the hard work and the advocacy of all of our hospital officials, frontline workers and leaders, including the OHA, and I'm gratified that they're coming forward tomorrow to present in the as part of the pre-budget consultations. Their input and our close relationship is critically important to getting this right, and get it right we will. And we make decisions like the additional 1,200 beds, that the equivalent of six community hospitals that we've infused into the system. That's almost 10% of new beds into the province. We make decisions like that in concert and consultation with the OHA to make sure we are making the right steps.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Well, Speaker, it's hard to believe they can get it right when they've gotten it wrong for over a decade. The OHA's pre-budget submission says that, quote, an increase of 4.55% in hospital funding will ensure that hospitals have the resources needed to avoid a significant capacity crisis in Ontario's healthcare system, end quote. A significant capacity crisis. This is what the Liberals have delivered to Ontarians. We know that there are already thousands of patients lining the hallways of our hospitals across our province, and the OHA is saying that without this investment, it will only get worse. Will the Premier stop ignoring this crisis, start listening to the experts, and make the investments necessary to end hallway medicine in the province of Ontario?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
Speaker, we are listening and we are taking this seriously. What we won't do, though, is take lessons from a party, and the Leader of the Third Party represents the party that committed in the last campaign to eliminate $600 million out of health care and out of education. When they were in power in the 1990s, they closed 24% of all acute care beds. They closed 13% of mental health beds. In total, 9,600 beds were closed under them. But, Mr. Speaker, here's what the OHA has to say in their pre-budget submission. Ontario hospitals appreciate the Ontario government's leadership and continued investment in hospitals, including an increase in the 2017 Ontario budget and the winter plan to assist hospitals and the home and community care sectors in addressing high patient volumes. These investments will improve the health system's ability to manage the significant influx of patients expected during the flu season over the next number of months, Mr. Speaker. This is the kind of cooperation that we endorse, we support, and we enables us to make the right investments to build a strong system.
Your question for Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker.
Be seated, please. Thank you. Leader.
Thank you, Speaker. My next question is also for the Premier. The Premier's chronic underfunding of our hospitals, on top of years of conservative cuts, has created an overcrowding and hallway medicine crisis in Ontario. Today, the NDP released new information showing the extent of the damage that this Liberal government has caused in my hometown of Hamilton. Between June 1 and October 1, 2017, medical beds at St. Joseph's Healthcare in Hamilton were operating over 105% capacity every single day, Speaker. Temporary beds will not solve this crisis. When will the Premier finally do something to help people in Hamilton who are lying in stretchers, suffering because of her budget freezes?
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, we are making the necessary investments to ensure that our hospitals are able to address their what are often complex and multifactorial challenges when it comes to capacity. And in some parts of the province, like Peel, for example, or Mississauga and Halton, it's because there is a significant growth of the population. And in Hamilton, Mr. Speaker, we're making the correct investments to I wish I had the figures in front of me, Mr. Speaker, in terms of the additional beds that we've added to Hamilton Health Sciences, to St. Joseph's as well, to the entire community, to Jervinski on the mountain, Mr. Speaker, so that they are able to provide the care that is required and the highest quality of care that they provide on an ongoing basis, Mr. Speaker. That is in addition to the $500 million of funds that we've infused into the hospital system this year alone, on top of $500 million last year. We'll continue to invest in our hospitals, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Speaker, this new information shows that on any given day, the St. Joseph's Emergency Room, there are between 5 and 31 people waiting for an inpatient bed. They wait in unconventional spaces without a call button to even push if they need a nurse, and without a proper access to washroom facilities. When will this premier get serious and make sure that people of this province actually have reliable, quality health care when and where they need it?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, just a few weeks ago, we added 24 additional inpatient beds to St. Joseph's in Hamilton. We added 30 additional beds to Hamilton Health Sciences in Hamilton, Mr. Speaker. And in addition, 3 neonatal intensive care unit beds, 3 additional bassinets to care for those most vulnerable tiny individuals. Mr. Speaker, we are making the correct investments. We know as well, when we look from third-party information that we receive, that our wait times in hospitals, in emergency rooms, continue to go down because, despite an increased population. We're seeing that objective third-party data. And in fact, as I referenced last week, the report from the Fraser Institute, which says that Ontario has the best wait times in the country, Mr. Speaker.
Wow. Yep.
Your final supplementary.
Speaker, on August 10, 2017, St. Joseph's Hospital reached the alarmingly high occupancy rate of 139%. 139%. In fact, the OHA says that this is not uncommon in our hospitals across Ontario. In fact, it says that half of Ontario's hospitals were operating above 100% capacity this summer. These numbers represent real people in my community and all across Ontario who have been forced to get medical care from a hospital that is severely underfunded and overcrowded. Temporary beds, many of which are not in place yet, are simply not enough to begin fixing the decades of damage done by Conservative and Liberal cuts, and the OHA agrees, Speaker. Why is this Premier, why is she letting the people of Ontario down? Why is she letting them continue to suffer in overcrowded hospitals?
Thank you. Minister?
Well, Mr. Speaker, many people believe that the best illustration of a party's actions are to look at their actions in the past, Mr. Speaker, and look at their record. It's there for all to see. And from 1990 to 1995, those were awful years for Ontario's health care system, because they closed 24, a quarter of all of the acute care beds in this province. And I am even embarrassed to say as well for them that they closed 13% of the mental health beds in the province. And collectively, coming close to a PC record when they were in power, when the PCs closed 10,000 hospital beds, the NDP in 5 short years were responsible for closing 9,600 beds. We have added beds to the health care system. We have done that over the past years. We continue to do that this year. We will continue to make those important investments going forward.
Thank you. No question, the member from Bruce Gray.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. The Auditor General's 2017 report states that the backlog of complaints and critical incidents in the long-term care homes requiring inspection keeps increasing. This year, the backlog jumped to 3,370 from 2,800 last year. Minister, despite promises to fix the critical incidents backlog, we are not seeing the improvement. Sadly, the backlog has actually increased by 80%. I want to know, is the fact that you're not acting on critical inspections a sign that our senior safety and security is not a priority for your government?
Here, here. Good question.
Thank you. Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, it absolutely is a priority for this government. Apparently, it's not a priority for that party, because just yesterday they voted against our legislation that would have, that will be creating enhanced oversight and accountability and inspection and fines, all of those measures which are critically important to ensure that our loved ones and Ontarians who call long-term care their home, who are residents of long-term care, that they receive the highest quality care and the best supports. They voted just 24 hours ago, Mr. Speaker, against a whole set of measures that would have, that will, fortunately, because it passed despite their opposition, that it will dramatically enhance the inspection powers and the punitive measures that we can place on those most egregious homes that do need to improve the care that's being provided. Mr. Speaker, they did no inspections at all of long-term care homes. Every single year, we inspect 100% of our homes.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Supplementary. Thank you,
Mr. Speaker. Back to the Minister of Health. Must be an election in looming in the, yeah, in the near future, yeah, because for 14 years you've done nothing for that sector. Here. Delays in complaint inspections and critical incident inspections can place seniors in long-term care homes at risk. I think it's completely unacceptable that you are not meeting your promised goals, especially in light of the high-profile cases of abuse and the public inquiry into murders in long-term care homes. Families with loved ones in care have a right to expect that the safety and care of their patients will be your utmost priority. They want to see increased scrutiny. They want to see you making a difference, Minister. Will the Minister address the lingering questions around the safety, security and well-being of seniors by appearing before the public inquiry into long-term care?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, the Justice, and I am again gratified she met and heard from the families and loved ones of the victims of this horrible tragedy just yesterday, and will be making her decision over the coming months or month or so in terms of their participation in this inquiry. But Mr. Speaker, I have to get back to their bad math. So we've budgeted for 5,000 beds over the next 4 years, $380 million. They're proposing to create three times as many long-term care beds, but they've only budgeted $77 million.
Yeah.
Three times as many beds, one-fifth the amount that it's going to cost. So it costs about $60,000 per long-term care bed per year to operate that bed, Mr. Speaker. They've budgeted a measly $5,000.
The member from Elgin, Middlesex, London is warned. And I'm not happy with what he said. You have a wrap-up sentence?
Mr. Speaker, again, the math of their proposals is so bad, and I'm going to be happy to reveal it to them, and I'm happy to explain it to them, because they need to understand the lack of their commitment.
Thank you. New question? The member from London West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Speaker, throughout 5 long weeks of the college strike, this Liberal government assured students that they would not lose their semester. Yesterday, we learned that more than 25,000 full-time college students, about 1 in 10, have not only lost their semester, they have lost their dreams of a college education after being forced to drop out to get their tuition refunded. We know that more students will likely drop out after attempting to complete the condensed semester. As I have stated before, Sections 4 and 5 of the Ontario Colleges of Applied Arts and Technology Act allow the government to intervene in college affairs when it is in the public interest. Speaker, why did this government refuse to act to prevent the lives of more than 25,000 full-time students from being completely derailed? Sure.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I know that no one in this legislature is happy that there are students who have made the choice to leave college. Mr. Speaker, I say to the 90% of students who are back in the classroom, Mr. Speaker, I know that they're working hard, and I hope that it goes well for them, Mr. Speaker. I also say to the students who felt that they needed to withdraw and have received support by getting their tuition refunded, Mr. Speaker,
Speaker, which I think we can agree is the fair thing to do. I say to those students, Mr. Speaker, I hope they will work with their college, and I hope that they will find a way back into the system. And certainly it would be my expectation, our expectation, Mr. Speaker, that colleges will be reaching out to those students and helping them to see the path back. But, Mr. Speaker, to the 90% of students who are back in college, I wish them well, and to the rest, I hope that they will find their way back in January, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Again to the Premier. Speaker, the regular retention rate for a college term is 98%. In other words, just 2 out of 100 students choose not to complete their semester. After delaying the release of the tuition refund numbers, we now know that 1 in 10 full-time college students won't be completing their term. What we don't know is the number of part-time students who have opted to drop out, raising questions about how much worse the part-time numbers might be. Speaker, Ontarians deserve to know the total number of students who have been forced to put their lives on hold or give up their dreams because of this government's inaction. Will the Premier tell the people of Ontario how many part-time students have received a tuition refund and what the plan is to get both full-time and part-time students back on track?
Thank you. Premier.
Advanced Education and Skills Development.
For Advanced Education and Skills Development.
Well, Speaker, I just have to say every step of the way in getting students back into the classroom was blocked by that party. Those of us who were in this House debating back-to-work legislation, Speaker, remember the House leader, the NDP House leader, every chance we had to get students back, remember what he said?
No.
No.
Finish, please.
So, Speaker, whether it was not supporting free tuition for one-third of our students, Speaker.
Member from Etobicoke North is warned.
Or whether it was getting back students back to work after the strike, all back to school after the strike, all
Sir.
We heard from that party was no.
Thank you. New question, the member from Etobicoke North.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care and considers this government's extraordinary commitment and developments in mental health. Speaker, as a physician himself, I know that the Minister of Health has a deep and abiding understanding of what mental health is all about. We in medical school, one of the first things we're ever taught in Latin is mens sana in corpore sana, a sound mind in a sound body. And I know from my many, many corridor consultations with the minister and the fact that we sit at the same table, by the way, at caucus, that he has personally treated patients with anxiety, depression, panic attack, post-traumatic stress disorder, and so many other disorders. I know, Speaker, that he has the background, history, stamina, partnerships, and the dedicated workforce to deliver on the type of health care that Premier Wynne, herself a daughter of a physician, demands for the people of Ontario. So my question is this. Can the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care please inform this House about the important investments our government is making in mental health across the province?
Thank you. Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And as Minister of Health, I believe that physical and mental health are two sides of the same coin. There can't be one without the other, Mr. Speaker. And I want to start off by saying how proud I am and how far we have come as a province. All parties in this legislature have pushed past the stigma, and we all agree that together we need to do more. And it's important to take a moment to appreciate how all Ontarians will benefit from that. Now, the Conservatives have come to the table offering an average of $191 million a year over the next 10 years, Mr. Speaker, but they forgot that before you announce an increase, you have to replace the base from the previous year, Mr. Speaker. I know as a province we can do better. We can work together to truly build the system, reduce wait times, and offer more services. Mr. Speaker, while the party opposite has come forward with $1.9 billion over 10 years, this team has put $10 billion more into the system since 2008, and a Liberal government will put more than $1.9 billion forward in investments in mental health over the next 10 years.
Thank you, Speaker. And once again, I thank the Minister of Health for his not only the answer today, but for his, as I said, abiding commitment to mental health along with physical and emotional health. Speaker, as you will know, he's a physician who has dealt with these issues on a one-to-one basis, as a public health physician, on a system-wide basis, as a public health physician, as a recognized internationally for his efforts in Africa with War Child for 10 years, and he's been recognized, as you know, and now running the entire show in the province of Ontario. As Gail Zucker, CEO of Addictions and Mental Health Ontario, was quoted in the Globe and Mail today, excellent mental health care is available from health professionals other than psychiatrists. Social workers, psychologists, psychotherapists, mental health and addiction counselors work across Ontario and publicly funded community mental health and addiction agencies.
Answer
Speaker,
question.
We are a long way from hula hoops. Minister, can you please tell this House again what is our government doing to further, under your stewardship, build up the mental health system of the province of Ontario?
Sir.
Mr. Speaker, we're working with experts and stakeholders and persons with lived experience, their loved ones across the province, to ensure that we're putting our investments in mental health where they are most and truly needed. And a key role of mine as Minister of Health in working with the Premier and this caucus is to put those necessary resources forward. Those resources like cognitive behavioral therapy, which will provide more than 100,000 Ontarians living with conditions such as anxiety and depression with more access to community-based structured psychotherapy services. Or our youth wellness hubs, Mr. Speaker, where young people aged 12 to 25 can find walk-in, one-stop access to mental health and addiction services and other health, social, and employment supports. Or creating more supportive housing, where this year up to 1,150 additional supportive housing units will be added on top of the 1,000 new units added over the last 3 years to help reduce homelessness and improve supports, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Halliburton-Burnham-Lakes-Brock.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Attorney General. Victim service organizations across the province are absolutely overwhelmed with requests for their services. Many are struggling to keep up with the sheer numbers, all while dealing with more complex cases, including victims of human sex trafficking. Halliburton Kawartha Victim Services in my riding received just $18,000 to hire someone under the Victim Quick Response Program last year. That was barely enough to hire even half a person. They made the most of it and helped dozens of trafficking victims. Unfortunately, this paltry amount was only one-time funding. They won't be able to continue their important work next year without a clear commitment from this government. So my question to the minister is, will he assure Halliburton Kawartha Victim Services that they will have the funding they need to help human sex trafficking victims in the new year?
Good question.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Speaker. This is an important question, and I want to be very clear that the Ontario government is very much committed to helping victims of crime when they need it the most. Speaker, since 2003, our government has invested over $1 billion on vital services to support those who have been harmed by crime. And as part of our government's strategy to end human trafficking, we will invest $1.93 million over 4 years to expand the benefits available under the Victim Quick Response Program to better serve victims of human trafficking. Speaker, we are also investing $6.65 million over 4 years to enhance the Victim Crisis Assistance Ontario program so that our community-based service delivery partners can provide better support and case coordination for victims of human trafficking. Speaker, further, as part of government sexual violence and harassment plan, in 2015, we increased funding to sexual assault centers by $1.75 million per year. Speaker, there's definitely more to do, and I remain very much committed to supporting victim services across the province.
Thank you. Very supplementary.
Well, Well, I'm glad to hear the minister is committed, but you seem happy to throw small amounts, pots of money at the problem, hoping that it will go away. It just shows that you're not taking the concerns of victim services organizations seriously. What I hear is that they are exasperated. They have not heard anything from the government in response to their call for a review of the current funding formula. Several of my colleagues on this side of the House have raised these concerns over the past several months from all across our ridings, Hope 24/7, for example, but this government is not listening. There is still no action. Mr. Speaker, will this government finally commit to a review of its victim service funding formula in consultation with providers to ensure that it meets the needs of victims in a sustainable way, Mr. Speaker?
Well done. Minister.
Speaker, this government has done more to support victim services than any other previous government. The work, Speaker, this government and this Premier has done in terms of putting an end to human trafficking, in terms of combating sexual violence and harassment, there is no example of any government in the history of Ontario, the amount of investments and policy work that has been done by this government. And Speaker, I'm very proud of being part of a government that takes these issues seriously because it goes to building an inclusive economy. Speaker, what worries us the most is the $12 billion cut that they have outlined, the Conservatives have outlined in their platform that's going to gut exactly these kinds of programs. It's okay for the member opposite to stand up and ask for more investment, whereby her own platform is going to cut all victim services and all these important funding for her community and communities across the province.
New question, the member from Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Corrections and Community Safety. Speaker, the Auditor General's report made it alarmingly clear that this Liberal government is not prepared to manage a major emergency in this province. The AG highlighted that emergency management plans haven't been updated since 2008 and that provincial nuclear emergency preparedness planning hasn't been updated since 2009. In communities like mine in Amherstburg, who are within the fallout radius of the Fermi 2 nuclear plant in Michigan, are left vulnerable with no support for a potential disaster from this government. We're joined here today in the gallery by Fire Chief Bruce Montone and Deputy Chief Lee Tome from the town of Amherstburg. They're here on behalf of our community to listen to your answer to this important question. And the question is the same one that this town has been asking since 2015. When will the Liberal government provide the same level of support to the town of Amherstburg as it does for other designated municipal areas that receive assistance in Ontario?
Thank you. Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services.
Thank you very much for the member for his question, and I want to say welcome to our legislature, to our chief here today. You know, Mr. Speaker, the Auditor General agreed that Ontario can respond and will respond to any emergency. And her findings were actually very consistent with those of our earlier independent review. Our response could be more efficient. And this is exactly why we launched our new Emergency Management Action Plan. And that includes the release of an updated Provincial Nuclear Emergency Response Plan in the coming weeks. We're also going to expand our emergency management capacity through agreements with our neighboring provinces and state to share supports and resources, and also supporting our municipality by making it easier to access critical supplies and resource, and by improving information and resource sharing, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, with all due respect, none of that answer addresses the issue that the town of Amherstburg is in right now. Speaker, the province has been aware since November 2015 that in the event of a nuclear accident at the Fermi 2 facility, the town of Amherstburg does not have the equipment, the personnel, the expertise, or the capacity to appropriately respond to such an event. Despite clear letters to this minister and submissions to the Provincial Nuclear Emergency Preparedness Plan highlighting the danger to our community, the minister has effectively ignored all of our concerns. Will the minister tell this House when the people in Amherstburg and the entire region of Essex County can expect the same resources and assistance so they can plan to be as safe as other designated communities in Ontario?
Well, I'm very happy to respond again to the question. You know, Mr. Speaker,
Our nuclear power has been the backbone of Ontario's energy supply for 40 years in Ontario, providing a clean energy that will help us to get rid of dirty coal and meet our GHG reduction goals. You know, when you look at what we are providing for a municipality such as Hammersburg, Hoffman, which is the our agency, will help from both our government and our further partner in supports with this with the municipality, will help actually strengthen its nuclear emergency management program. What we do, Mr. Speaker, is help work together, enhancing the planning, the training, our public education, emergency exercise to ensure that the community that has the continued ability to respond to emergency and nuclear. We've also took note of the letter that was sent during the public consultation, and our expert panel has
Thank you. New question, the member from Davenport.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question this morning is for the Attorney General. My constituents in Davenport are accessing more services and getting more things done on just their smartphones than ever before. They are shopping online, resolving their disputes, banking, and setting up mortgages all on their tablets. They expect that level of convenience in all aspects of their life. In the ever-evolving world around us, the justice system has just not kept pace. Mountains of paper, endless filing, and mandatory in-person attendance for things that just do not need to be in person all make for a system that is sorely out of date. That is why I was so pleased to see the Attorney General last week announce new measures to bring the justice system into the 21st century. These new measures, which the Attorney General has called putting justice within reach, are incredibly important. Can the Attorney General please explain how this plan will actually put justice within reach for my constituents?
Thank you, Attorney General.
Thank you very much, Speaker. I want to thank a member from Davenport for asking a very timely question. Speaker, in order to act and maintain access to justice, Ontario's justice system must continue to adapt and evolve to continue meeting the needs of the people it serves every day. That is why, Speaker, the Ministry of the Attorney General is committed to making the justice system simpler, faster, and more affordable for all Ontarians. We are developing and delivering user-centered, consumer-focused digital services that are faster, that are easier to navigate, and low or no cost to the people who use it. Speaker, in the next year, new online 24/7 paperless options will be available for getting more important tasks completed more easily and conveniently. One example, Speaker, of this plan will be that Ontarians can use new digital tools for potential jurors, for example, to complete questionnaires online and receive summonses by email. Speaker, by introducing modern technology and developing data systems that allow information to be shared with the click of a button, Ontario is reducing waste and inefficiency.
Thank you. Supplementary.
And I would like to thank the Attorney General for his response. It is very exciting that my constituents can expect a modernized justice sector. However, Mr. Speaker, we have heard many promises to modernize our justice system before. While the news is exciting, I do point to how far behind the justice system has fallen behind in terms of modernization, and I wonder what will the Attorney General be doing this time to ensure that this does not this actually happens this time. This is a necessary change, and we have a long road ahead, but this is a step in the right direction. However, the systems in place have been around for so long. What makes the Attorney General think that he will be able to change a system that has been operating the same way for such a long period of time? A system that is inherently known for sticking to tradition. Can the Attorney General please give clarity to this chamber on why this modernization will actually happen this time?
He's good at it.
We have to modernize our justice system. It's something that I've identified as a priority for our government and for our ministry. And, Speaker, we are taking steps that are practical and prudent in making sure that we are bringing digital options for users of our justice system across the province, whether it starts from e-filing in our small claims court or for civil matters, or, Speaker, in spring, very soon, we will have joint divorces that could be filed online as well. These are just some practical examples of things that we are already doing. Speaker, that is why also we have outlined all our priorities in a digital justice action plan so that Ontarians have a roadmap available to them with timelines
Answer.
So they can keep us accountable. Speaker, what worries me is when I see the opposition conservatives platform where there's no talk about how we will modernize the system. Speaker, we need to be mindful of that.
Thank you. New question, the member from Dufferin-Caledon.
Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Transportation. 12 years ago, the GTA West Corridor was identified in the growth plan for the Greater Golden Horseshoe. Since then, the minister has consistently dragged his feet on the environmental assessment of the GTA West. 2 years ago, the minister took the unprecedented move of suspending the environmental assessment. My Freedom of Information request shows that the Ministry of Transportation has spent over $14 million studying the highway corridor with nothing to show for it. This week will mark the second anniversary since the minister suspended the environmental assessment. Why the delay, Minister?
Thank you. Minister of Transportation.
Thanks very much, Speaker. I thank the member from Dufferin-Caledon for her question. She may not be aware of this. A number of days ago, on the ministry's website, we posted that there will be an update regarding this particular project that will be taking place within 60 days of that notice going up on the website, Speaker. I'm extremely proud to be part of a government that has literally invested billions of dollars in highways in every corner of the province, Speaker. Just the other day, I joined with members from the government caucus in Brampton, where we announced and officially opened up lanes for the widened Highway 410 in that neighbourhood, Speaker. A few days later, I was standing alongside in the brisk weather, the member from Etobicoke Centre and the Minister of Housing and was the Minister responsible for poverty reduction as we opened lanes on Highway 427, Speaker, in northern Etobicoke. And, Speaker, on that same day, out in Durham, in the Clarendon area, Speaker, standing alongside the Minister of Agriculture and the Minister, the member from Durham, we announced that starting in January, Highway 407 East Phase 2A will be open to vehicular traffic, and I look forward to providing more.
Thank you. Supplementary.
The only thing the minister has done on the GTA West corridor is continue to kick the can down the road. You announced it 2 years ago, you announced it a year ago, and now you're saying another 60 days. What's the delay? The reality is that the land along the proposed route of the GTA West has been frozen for years. Peel and York Region and municipalities around the GTHA have been calling for the minister to finish the environmental assessment. Residents and municipalities have no faith that this minister will finally make a decision on the future of the project. After all, the minister has committed in the past to provide, quote, updates, only to find another reason to delay. After $14 million spent, will the minister commit today to restarting the environmental assessment of the GTA West corridor?
Thank you, Minister.
Speaker, as I mentioned a second ago, our government's record when it relates to highway construction is unprecedented. We are literally, again, investing in highways in the GTHA and in every corner of the province of Ontario. Speaker, what I will not accept and what I will not contend with gracefully in this chamber, Speaker, is a member of Ontario's Conservative Party. Let's not forget, this would be the party that first tolled and then sold Highway 407 to a Spanish consortium, Speaker. I will not take lectures from a member from Patrick Brown and the Ontario Conservatives caucus when it comes to highways that are needed here in this province, Speaker. We know, Speaker, we know all about their people's guarantee, and we know one thing, Speaker, what's guaranteed in their plan, should they ever come to power, Speaker, will be less infrastructure investments, will be less public transit, will be fewer highways where they're needed, Speaker, will be less money for cycling infrastructure, Speaker.
I consider it a test, so I'm going to pass. The member from Bruce Gray Owen Sound is warned. Time's up. New question, the member from Kitchener-Waterloo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. My office is working with Patricia and Don Dayton. Patricia and Don have been married for 64 years, but they are currently forced to live apart because they have differing health needs. Patricia is in the dementia unit at University Gates, a long-term care facility, while Don is living at the West Hill Retirement Home. Every morning, Don takes a cab to visit Patricia at her long-term care facility so that they can have breakfast together. It breaks his heart to leave her each day. Our seniors should not have to go to such great lengths to be together, especially at a time when they need each other the most. Currently, Don and Patricia are on a very long reunification waitlist to the Waterloo Wellington Lynn. Speaker, what will this government do to reunite Don and Patricia as soon as humanly possible?
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And if I understand the question correctly, that one individual is currently in a retirement home and the other is in a long-term care home. I'm not sure if the first individual has been assessed and is eligible for long-term care or not. Perhaps the member could address that in the supplementary. But we are, in fact, making important changes. I, quite frankly, call them dramatic changes. And one of the member's colleagues, I have to acknowledge, the member from Niagara, was instrumental in encouraging us and helping us look to this issue of reunification of loved ones, of couples, elderly couples, Mr. Speaker. So we're making changes that will, and I need to be careful, I'm not sure if the regulation is still posted, proposed changes that will make it much easier for our long-term care homes and
Answer.
For those individuals to be reunited. But perhaps the member, if she doesn't mind, could just indicate whether the individual in retirement is eligible for long-term care.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr.
Supplementary.
Speaker, and I will tell the minister that there is a letter in his office with the details. But, Speaker, we need a dramatic change on long-term care almost a decade ago. Otherwise, we would not be in this position right now today. Retirement should not be marked by stress and uncertainty. Dawn and Patricia's story is just one of the many stories of seniors in my community who are forced to live separately. The waiting time for Dawn and Patricia to be reunited is currently estimated at more than 1,000 days. These numbers are truly heartbreaking. Couples like Dawn and Patricia, who have been together for 64 years, shouldn't have to wait 3 years to be reunited. The Dayton's experiences exemplify a broken and fragile long-term care system that is struggling to accommodate our aging population. Will the minister please tell Dawn and Patricia and every single family affected by the shortcomings of the long-term care system why is it acceptable that they wait years to be reunited with their loved ones?
Thank you. Minister?
Well, Mr. Speaker, that's exactly precisely why we're making these changes. And I'm still not sure if the first individual is eligible for long-term care, because obviously if he is not, that would make it more challenging. But Mr. Speaker, we are, and I'm going to say proposed, because again, I'm not sure if the reg, if it's a reg or if it was in the legislation yesterday, but Mr. Speaker, we're actually creating a separate category specifically to enable us and our long-term care homes and our LHINs and families to reunite those sorts of individuals who are both eligible for long-term care, who want to appropriately, and we should encourage this and facilitate this, who want to live together and live those remaining years together as a couple. So, Mr. Speaker, we're precisely addressing, and I guess, again, I have to give credit to my collaboration with the member from Niagara, because we looked at this and how together we might actually evolve a system where improvements are required, and I believe we've got a fix, we've got a solution which will address precisely
Thank
what the
you.
Member is asking for.
Question, the member from Ottawa, Vanier.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Ma question...
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the minister responsible for young children.
I know firsthand how important access to a daycare is. I had four children that were attending daycare at different parts of my life, so I know that affordability and suitability to needs is very important to all inclusive families. Now, in the riding that I have the privilege of representing, Ottawa-Vanier, there are many new families that are arriving and are very anxious to know what are the daycare options that are available to them. The anxiety raised to cost and to the suitability of the options that are available to the variety of their needs. So I want to ask whether the minister can help us say what the government
Question.
Is doing to meet this very important need in our different communities.
Minister responsible for early years and childcare.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the hardworking member from Ottawa-Vanier for this very important question. She has been a strong advocate on this issue. Speaker, we know families across this province are facing challenges when it comes to finding childcare. That's why our government is working tirelessly to help Ontario families find affordable, accessible, quality childcare options. In fact, this week we announced that more than 8,400 children will benefit from the opening of 493 new childcare rooms in close to 200 schools across the province. It's amazing news. Local schools are being renovated and retrofitted for these spaces. This investment is part of our five-year commitment to help 100,000 more children access spaces. As part of this investment, we announced $200 million in the 2017 budget, which created 24,000 spaces. 16,000 of those are subsidized.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thanks to the Minister.
For her absolute commitment to this essential aspect of life for Ontario families. It is very important for the future of Ontario to have good daycare and to have access to all the care spaces that are needed. Indeed, I think we know that there's a lot of work that needs to be done and that families want to know as well how the system will operate. There's some governance issues. People want to know where are the spaces going to be allocated.
I know in my riding particular the question is asked regularly, how will the places be allocated throughout the province?
I know exactly what the future of daycare will look like in Ontario, and I wish, s'il vous plaît, the minister could comment on how this 100,000 spaces will be allocated.
Merci. Thank you. Minister, Madame la Ministre.
Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to answer the member's important question, and absolutely people need to know where the spaces are going. Speaker, we are investing $1.6 billion in new capital funding, which supports the creation of 45,000 new spaces in schools, public spaces, and communities across the province. As I mentioned, we're building over 8,400 new spaces in 188 schools in Ontario. This includes 45 projects in French language schools, 81 projects in Catholic schools, 50 childcare projects in rural and northern school boards, creating 1,800 new childcare spaces in that region.
Wow.
Speaker, these investments in close to 200 schools are helping us to fulfill our commitments. It's a historic investment, one that will benefit all of Ontario, and you will hear more about where these spaces are going in the coming weeks. Speaker, we're helping families with access to quality childcare, and we're building.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. When I was commending the member for good collaboration
you,
on spousal reunification and long-term care, I actually should have said the member from Niagara Falls.
All members have a right to correct their record, and that's true. The member from Thornhill on a point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And this Sunday, the Vaughan Metropolitan Subway station is opening. My riding of Thornhill is where it's going to be opening. My constituents are very excited. The constituents in York Region are very excited. Unfortunately, they are excited.
Order. Although it's not a point of order, I'll let the member finish quickly.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's their taxpayers' money. I've asked to be invited to the grand opening. Please don't be petty and part.
The member from Trinidad Spadina on a point of order.
Thank you, Speaker. I would like to welcome a very active member of the Filipino community, Ms. Melinda Malapaz. She's here with us in the members' gallery. Welcome to Queen's Park.
Thank you. The member from Oxford on a point of order.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, during question period, I noticed that my able assistant from my Woodstock constituency office, Shelley Raliband, is here sitting in the audience. And I'd like to welcome her to Queen's Park.
You're welcome. Pursuant to Standing Order 38A, the member from Bruce Gray Owen Sound has given the notice of his dissatisfaction with his answer given to him during question period by the Minister of Health Long-Term Care concerning the Auditor General's report on long-term care. This matter will be debated today at 6 p.m. We have a deferred vote on the motion of third reading of Bill 166, an act to... We have a deferred vote on the motion of third reading of Bill 166, an act to amend and repeal various acts and to enact three new acts with respect to the construction of new homes and ticket sales and events. Call in the members. This will be a five-minute bill. members, please take your seats. On December 6, 2017, Mr. Nackey moved third reading of Bill 166, an act to amend or repeal various acts and to enact three new acts with respect to construction of new homes and ticket sales for events. All those in favor, please rise one at a time. You're recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Nackey.
Mr. Nackey.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mrs. Sandals.
Mrs. Sandals.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Duga.
Mr. Duga.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Tebow.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Codrey.
Mr. Codrey.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Mrs. Manga.
Mrs. Manga.
Mr. Crack.
Mr. Crack.
Ms. Domino.
Ms. Domino.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mrs. Verniel.
Mrs. Verniel.
Madame DeRosier.
Madame DeRosier.
Mrs. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time to be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller Perry Salmuskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Salmuskoka.
Mr. McNaught.
Mr. McNaught.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Romano.
Mr. Romano.
Mr. Osterhout.
Mr. Osterhout.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Mrs. Marteau.
Mrs. Marteau.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Cho.
Mr. Cho.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Monsieur Bisson.
Monsieur Bisson.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Madame Gelina.
Madame Gelina.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Tabin.
Mr. Tabin.
Ms. Sadler.
Ms. Sadler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Natasha.
Mr. Natasha.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Monsieur Monta.
Monsieur Monta.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mrs. Gretzky.
Mrs. Gretzky.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
The ayes are 50, the nays are 43. The ayes being 50, the nays being 43, I declare the motion carried.
Third reading of the bill, troisième lecture du projet de loi.
Be it resolved that the bill do now pass and be entitled as in the motion. There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.